Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is a guest of Drew Mariani in his eponymous show on Relevant Radio, where they're discussing Catholics and divorce.
Hey, a couple things. Talking about Pope Francis, right? Let's talk a little bit more about another aspect, something that affects all families, and that's divorce and illness. All right, I want to talk a little bit about this. When the Pope and the bishops meet next year for the Synod on the Family, I mean, one of the questions I'm sure is going to be raised is the question of divorce and its effect on the family. And it's obvious that divorce, of course, breaks up a family, but something else that researchers are now finding, and this has been in the news for probably the past 2 weeks or so, pretty interesting, that divorce is bad for your health. Divorce has bad effects on your health. Gentlemen, you do better if you're married. Did you know that? You do better if you're married. According to the Journal of Men's Health, divorced men have more health problems than married men. Your blood pressure's higher. They have more heart attacks. They got more strokes, cancer, and even more colds. Even more colds. Divorced men are likely to die earlier. They have higher rates of alcohol and substance abuse. 10.4% of divorced men, they get depressed, while the rate is only about 2% for married men. That's a pretty big number. And they have, of course, a 39% higher suicide rate. That's scary than married men do. Divorced fathers have poorer relationships with their children, less emotional support. That's kind of common sense. But, of course, the common wisdom is that it's better to be out of a stressful relationship, right? But at least for men, it doesn't really appear that way. Joining me today, Dr. Jennifer Roback-Marsh. She's the founder and president of the Ruth Institute. It's a project of the National Organization for Marriage. She's a senior fellow in economics at the Acton Institute as well for the study of religion and liberty. And she's been a guest here in the past. You can check her out at ruthinstitute.org. She's doing great, great stuff. Author of a couple of cool books, too. You can check them out. Smart Sex and Love and Economics is two of the books that I have personally on the bookshelf as well. Hey, Doc, good to have you back. Good afternoon.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Drew.
When I saw these divorce stats, I said, I'm glad I'm married. And I thought, hey, you'd be a great person to talk to about that. That article was about men. Give me your take on that. How accurate are those stats? And what should we take away from that?
Well, you know, Drew, that basic line of information has been in the literature for, I don't know, maybe 20 years now. You know, the idea that men have a higher suicide rate when they get divorced, that has been around long enough. I included that in the very first little marriage tips booklet that I wrote, you know, almost 10 years ago now. You know, so that the idea that men's suicide rate is tripled by being divorced, that you know, that information, that's been out there for a long time. The real question is, why don't people talk about it? Why doesn't the mainstream media really get the message that people are happier in relationship, that it's worth it to work on the relationship rather than to just throw away people and throw away relationships? That's the real puzzle as far as I'm concerned, because the evidence is quite clear, and it has been for quite a while.
You know, that's on men. What about women? Any studies that show the effects of divorce on a woman's health?
Well, you know, it's not as pronounced on women, you know, because part of what's happening is women are more relational creatures in the first place, right? And so women are assisting men, right? That women's relationality is assisting men. So when the marriage breaks up, it's not always as dramatic for women as it is for men, the impact on health. But it's still not nothing. You know, women are healthier if they're married rather than being divorced.
Yeah, I think the Pope recognizes the importance of family and marriage. Oh. I was just talking about a synod that's going to be called. Several headlines recently coming up as well about divorced and remarried Catholics. The Holy Father's position on this, what do you think he's going to do? Is he going to be a real leader in terms of trying to address this issue and help such a wounded portion of our population?
Well, you know what? He is so interesting. He is so interesting because, you know, a lot of the, you know, kind of dissidents within the Catholic Church and a lot of the pro-choice people in the mainstream media, they want to claim him. Like, oh, man, this is great. He's our guy, you know, kind of thing. And you know, really, when the National when NARAL takes out an ad saying, thank you, Pope Francis, you got to go, wait a minute, what is going on here, you know? Well, what's going on is they're not looking too closely at the whole story of what he's saying, because, you know, in some of these very controversial interviews, if you read them closely and see the context of what he's saying, you'll see he's not changing the church's teaching one iota. Not a bit. It's like he's throwing out a lifeline to people who are suffering and who are struggling. So on the divorce question, for example, I mean, in one of these interviews, he said, you know, a divorced person can receive communion, but a person who has remarried cannot receive communion. Well, now you tell me, isn't that the teaching? Isn't that, as long as I've been alive, that's the teaching, right? You know, so he's not saying anything new, but he's saying it in a different way. And with any luck, he's going to be accessible to people who maybe haven't been able to hear it before. So I picture the bark of St. Peter, Drew, mm-hmm. like this. I picture, you know, the ship that we know is going to make it into the harbor. You know, we know, Jesus told us, you know, that the bark of St. Peter is going to make it. And so Pope John Paul is up there steering and, you know, guiding the ship, and Pope Benedict's down below decks doing repairs, you know, with all of his brilliance and everything. And Pope Francis is at the back, throwing out life preservers, you know.
I love
all
it.
These people are bobbing in the sea out there, you know, and there's so many wounded souls, Drew.
Wow.
So many, so much suffering from the sexual revolution. So when Pope Francis says the church needs to be a field hospital and tend to the wounded souls, when you're in the field hospital, you've got to deal with the gaping wounds. You don't worry about people's cholesterol level. You've got to deal with the fact that they're bleeding in front of you. And that, I think, is what needs to be our approach with the sexual revolution. Here at the Ruth Institute, we've decided that the new direction we need to take is to be reaching out to people who have been victimized by the sexual revolution, people who have been wounded. And the top of the list are people who are, you know, for instance, children of divorce, absolute victims. The other people at the top of the list, the reluctantly divorced, the person who wants to stay married but who is divorced because the government takes the side of the party that wants the marriage the least.
What's your thought on that? About no-fault divorce has been terrible for the country, but I know a woman who loved her husband very much, did not want a divorce, and yet he wanted out, and that was it. There was nothing she could do. I mean, it was over because he wanted out. You say that's a product of the sexual revolution?
Oh, no kidding. I mean, look, without the divorce being what was, I consider the two big pillars of the sexual revolution to be divorce and contraception.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because divorce redefined marriage and made marriage into a non-permanent, you know, something or other that's just for adults. You know, it changed the whole character of the meaning of marriage. And so what happened to your friend is unfortunately all too common, because the government, what No Fault says, is it says you can get divorced for any reason or no reason without even giving an account of yourself.
Yeah.
And so that means that the government is going to take sides with the person who wants to be married the least. Rather than the government saying, hey, the marriage bond is socially valuable, it's a contract where the people have real obligations to one another, it's a covenant where the adults have real obligations.
Yeah, but here's the thing, you know,
they won't defend that. Yeah. That's the vision of marriage that the
But you can understand that, can't you? I mean, I you know, as much as I don't agree with it, I can understand it. There's almost an inequity here, but in some respects, gosh, the government's saying, well, why would you want to stay in a relationship with somebody who doesn't love you or want to be in that? And we want to let them out so they can go on and be in a relationship in which they are happy. So this wife who loves her husband and wants to be faithful, and he's sick and tired of her, and he wants out. It's a tough situation. What do? You trap the man and say, look, you signed a contract for life and you're stuck with me whether you like it or not. And then there's infidelity and a whole litany of other issues.
Well, look at that. Until about 1968, that's actually what the law of marriage was. It was presumed to be permanent, and if people were unhappy inside the marriage, the presumption was that they'd figure out some way to deal with it. And the way to deal with it is as varied as the number of couples there are. Right? There are all kinds of ways to deal with those kind of issues, and some couples, you know, made each other miserable and enjoyed making each other miserable and made everybody around them miserable. And some couples worked it out, you know, and saw that as the path to holiness is that I'm going to continue to love my spouse, even though he's being a pain in the neck and a jerk and all the rest of it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to continue to love him. And so,
you're right.
You know, adults recognize And I think we all, as just realistic people, we have to recognize that sometimes marriage is a cross. There's no doubt about it.
It's such a great point. Such a great point. And that was her perspective. Actually, she's trying to start a movement within the church to get the church to be more supportive, because that's what she said. She says, I am going to love him even if he doesn't love me. Because she believed her marriage was sacramental. She went into it. Something went astray with him somehow, some way. I don't know whether, what went on in his head, but he left her, and she says, I'm going to pray for him, and I'm going to love him, and I'm going to be faithful to him. And she continued to do that.
Yeah, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Because when divorce happens, that's when the adults put down the cross and the children pick it up.
You're right.
Right. And so we can't have that. We can't. So this woman you're talking about, I really admire her. When we get off the phone, I want you to connect us.
Yeah, I will, because I think...
Because at the Ruth Institute, we are about to put on a conference called Healing the Family.
It's
for adults. It's for adults. It's not just for our students like we've always done before. We're looking for people like your friend there. We're looking for people who have been wounded by the sexual revolution and who are ready to reach out and help others and who are ready to do something to heal this culture and to heal their own families and to help others heal their families and to do something about the structural problems that we have in this culture. Yeah. So I want to meet your friend.
I'll give you her name. And she was trying to work on a book, and she's got a whole, she's really trying to move this particular thing forward. Because, it really is a way to holiness, too. Carrying that type of cross and being faithful to the vocation that you've made, you can grow in sanctity and achieve a really high level of sainthood as a result of that. And I think most people think, well, there's nothing I can do. I love him, but good luck. I'm going to move on with my own life. And that's what this divorce culture has brought about. Let me grab a quick call or two. You can join us if you would like to share your thoughts, ask your questions, add your comments here at 877-766-3777. Easy way to remember. That's 877-ROME-777. Mark in Chicago, good afternoon.
Hey, Drew, how you doing?
Hey, Mark, great.
I remember hearing this story from a man one time who was on the radio, and he was married in the church, and his wife, after a few years of marriage, his wife, was in an adulterous relationship with another man, and she left her husband for this other man. And he had a lot of faith, and he told her that he would not, that he forgave her for what she did, but he's not going to move on because he made a vow before God. And of course, she moved on, divorced her husband through a government, married this other man. And it was so powerful because he kept faith for years. He didn't move on. It was hard. He prayed for her. And after three years of marriage to her, to this other man, they divorced, and she got hooked on drugs, very depressed. And then just one day, probably after 4 years after they separated, divorced and all that, but she came back to him, and she asked him for help because she needed help because she was in a very lonely place. And he helped her, and a few years after that, they wind up rekindling their relationship and remarrying, and now they got children, and it's just like they've had a strong marriage for, I'm not sure how long it's been now, but it's probably like 15 or more years, and it's just an amazing, amazing story of, what faith can do. And when you are truly involved in marriage and believe the vows that you make, changes do happen, even in the other person.
Wow. Well, that's a great story. Mark, thanks so much for sharing it. Doctor, I'm going to let you respond to Mark as well. Beautiful testimony.
Well, that's a beautiful testimony. That's a beautiful story, and it's a beautiful story of fidelity and genuine love, because his love for his wife was countercultural, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely countercultural. Yeah. And what he did by doing that is think of what he protected his children from. But, one of the things that is so difficult about remarriage after divorce is the impact that has on children.
Yeah,
now, because I give these kind of talks to college students, I've had college students tell me, that when their mom remarried, for example, that she and her siblings were sitting in the back of the church crying.
Wow.
The kids are not happy just because mom's happy. The kids are back there crying because mom's remarriage tells them definitively that their mother and father are never going to get back together again. And that's the impact that it actually has on kids. And we don't really think about that. Mm-hmm. That you're now asking the child to have a relationship with this new person. It's like, gee, back in the day, nobody was ever asked to do that.
I love your line. You have a great line. When couples divorce, the children pick up the cross, right? They lay down their cross and the kids pick it up. Let me go back to the phones. We'll take another call. This next caller comes anonymously and is in a very difficult marriage right now. Hey, Anonymous, good afternoon.
Oh, hello. I just turned the show on. I didn't even know Jennifer's name. I just want to cry because I returned to my sacramental marriage after a 16-year civil divorce.
Wow.
After I left the church and was in the divorce culture. I was in a Protestant church that told me I had a biblical divorce, which was a joke. But anyway, I came back to the church, and then Blessed Mother led me back to my marriage. We're still separated, but I see what led me back to the church was just the purity of the sacrament of marriage and authority. And I am one of several women I know who are in very difficult marriage situations, but continuing. And I've just been on my own struggling with what does God want me to do with this? Because divorce does not solve the problems. It just makes it worse. And I love what you said. When divorced couples, they give the cross to the children, and people are, and I say the same thing myself, we are suffering from the whole contraceptive divorce mentality, and people don't even know it. It's like, what do we do with it?
Oh, wow. Anonymous, thank you so much for calling. Let me invite you also to come to the Ruth Institute's conference in January. You're exactly perfect candidate for it, right?
Wow.
Because you have suffered. And when you got divorced in the first place, and maybe even when you chose the person that you chose to marry, and maybe you weren't thinking straight when you picked that person, and you know, all kinds of things happened that led you into the suffering that you're in now. The sexual revolution has victimized so many people, and what we want to do is help people to do just what you just did, which is to connect the dots between what you did and the lies that you bought and the pain that you're suffering now. And our hope is that by getting people our age, of our generation, and helping us to see, helping us to connect those dots, we can then be witnesses to the younger generation so that they don't have to go through it and learn it all on their own the way we all had to do. Because I think
that is my hope. And my husband and I never had any children, and I offer up my suffering to help prevent other couples. Just persevere.
Wow.
Just seek the sacraments and God, because that's the only healing.
Beautiful. I was reading an article just the other day that says that Catholics continue to have the lowest divorce rates. Is that still true? Is that accurate? That if you are Catholic, your marriage has a better shot?
I think that's right. I saw that study as well, and I think that's right. A lot of times you'll hear people say, oh, Christians have the same divorce rate as everybody else.
Right.
Christians are hypocrites, blah, blah, blah. But if you break down the data a little bit more and you ask, well, who's a Catholic who actually goes to Mass every Sunday versus who's a Catholic who says I was Catholic because I was baptized and I made my first communion 100 years ago?
Right.
You know, if you separate by regular religious practice, that's what the sociologists call it, regular religious practice is a very strong protective factor against divorce.
Got it.
Right. That's the nerdy way to put it. But the spiritual way to put it is that if you are deeply involved with your faith, you're going to be graced by that. You're going to be graced by God, and that's going to help you deal with the moments when your spouse is being a jerk or when the situation is impossible or,
you know,
when everyone's exhausted and, you know, I need love and my husband needs love and we both need love and there's not enough love. Well, you go sit in front of the tabernacle and now there's love, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And you don't have that if you're trying to make it up by yourself or go it alone as a secular person, you know.
Yeah.
So this is the great advantage that we have as Roman Catholics. And doggone it, Drew, as Catholics, we have no right to keep that to ourselves. We got to share that with people. We got to talk about it and help people to connect those dots, you know, to see that the love we have for one another inside marriage is an image of God's love for us. And we want to be that image, and we want to receive that from God, you know. And half the time we aren't even able to receive from others. We aren't able to receive from our spouses even, because we feel like it makes us dependent and weak, and we hate that. And, you know, and that's crazy. That's actively in the way of real love, you know.
It really is. Let me go back to the phones. Anonymous is joining us as well. Hi, Anonymous.
Hi. Hey. Thank you for taking my call.
You're welcome.
Yes, I've been in touch with Dawn Eden, who's the convert author who wrote the book recently, My Peace I Give You, Healing Sexual Wounds Through the Lives of the Saints.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason it's so relevant to me is 25 years ago, my husband and I became engaged, but before we became engaged, my husband sobbed in my arms and said that he had been sexually abused by his own mother's father, so his maternal grandfather, and he just, you know, he'd never told anyone in the family. And I decided, you know, that I really wasn't sure how that might manifest itself in our marriage, but I took that leap of faith, and we were happily married 21 years, and then something horrible happened. He was sexually harassed by a boss who developed the same-sex attraction to him.
Wow.
And because we were actually living and working at the place where this happened, and unfortunately it was through the Catholic Church, this was actually a priest, we for 10 months suffered a lot of interior suffering, and it caused infighting between my husband and me. And so anyway, I actually got a hold of Dr. Richard Fitzgibbons, who counseled us over the phone. And unfortunately, it did not go in the direction I had hoped. My husband, after 10 months of compiling text messages and things, he did give all this information to the bishop, but then he just left. He fled. He didn't stick around to do anything. And so he actually abandoned the kids and me. We lost our home to foreclosure. I lost my job. And however, let me just say, I still love him. I forgive him because I know that he's psychologically and spiritually ill. I forgive the priest. I forgive the church. I love our Holy Mother Church. I am a devout Catholic. I always have been. We homeschooled our kids for 6 years. I just really, really trust in Jesus. And every day when I pray the chapel, I say, please, Jesus, if you would only, this is where Dawn's book has come in really handy. I've asked our Lord in the sacrament of Holy Communion to enter into the wounds of my heart. And because my husband and I are one in the flesh, enter into the wounds of his heart through my heart and heal us. And he unfortunately eloped with a Jehovah's Witness who's been married four times.
Boy. That's something else.
It's about as bad as it can get.
It really
so
is.
I trust in Jesus.
I love your faith. I'll tell you that much. We're going to pray for you right now, okay?
Oh, that would be great. I'd love that.
As the chaplet is about to begin, we will lift you up in a very special way. And, Doctor, I'm out of time. Best site to get in touch with you and learn more, ruthinstitute.org, right?
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Drew Mariani discussing Catholics and divorce on Relevant Radio's The Drew Mariani Show. For the calls at the end of the segment, thank you for sharing your stories. We are so sorry you went through such abandonment and pain. We want to help your healing process if we can, and we're sharing the info as part of our mission to help others avoid it by encouraging and supporting marriage. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.